I can see my two guys for the next 45 minutes. It's 4 months now after the US election, and it's clear that there were some strengths which influenced the election. And I really would like to talk about this topic with two guys. One of him is John Iderola. I hope I pronounced that correctly. He's a YouTube celebrity, I can say that. He's the host and creator of Think Tank. He's got 1.2 million subscribers on his YouTube channel. And he has a big passion for politics. And please welcome on stage, John. Take a seat.
Thank you. Right here?
Yeah.
Thank you.
The second man I would like to introduce is a presenter and producer and a journalist of Euronews. He's covering for Euronews the topic space, sky tech, and innovation. And he works in news organizations since 1994. With Euronews, he is since 2001, and he's covered a lot of elections in the previous time. And please welcome on stage Jeremy Wilkes.
Hello, everybody. Hello.
Hi. Thanks for joining me here.
We got on the comfy sofa.
I just said you covered a lot of elections in the last century, I would say.
And yes, thank you. Remind me of my age.
And you told me that you had some strong thoughts about the last election, especially in the U.S. What's your opinion? Why did Donald Trump become president of the United States?
Oh, well, I think that's quite clearly because the other candidate wasn't really good enough, actually. I think that probably if Joe Biden had stood for it, then he probably would be president now. I think that's quite... I think a lot of people totally underestimated the dislike for Hillary Clinton amongst an awful lot of people in America, and that she wasn't really the right candidate. Obviously, he's an awful president as well, but I think that's probably why he ended up winning. You talk about covering an awful lot of elections. My first elections that I covered were local elections, which are wonderful. You're really close to people. That was the Labour election in 1997 when Tony Blair came to power. The internet was not a big, powerful thing then, and it was quite clearly a big landslide. There was a huge swell of popular support. But since then, obviously, we've had a huge change, haven't we? Because now we've got so much competing sources of information that we didn't have then, even 10 years ago, I suppose. I've just been talking to some of our correspondents for Euronews all around the world, actually, about this question of whether fake news can influence elections or not. And there are some very diverse points of view on that. I just spoke to James Franey, who covered the Dutch elections for us the other week. He's a British reporter for Euronews, and he said no way that there was any influence there whatsoever for fake news. When I speak to Stefan Grober, our correspondent in Washington, he just ranted on the phone for half an hour about Trump and the fakeness of Trump, and that was really the main problem, which if you look at Trump's Twitter feed, which I'm sure everybody does, that's what he spends his time doing, right? But the most striking example I just had was talking to Sergio Cantone, who's Italian, and he is used to be the bureau chief in Kiev for Euronews, and now he's the bureau chief in Brussels. And he said that absolutely what happened in Crimea and eastern Ukraine was the result of fake news. Because he said basically the Russian media, lots of Russian media outlets, painted a picture of the Ukrainian protesters in Maidan as fascists who were going to come to the East and murder people, rape women, kill children. That was the picture that was painted of these people, and so they took up arms against them. And so he said, okay, this isn't an election, but it's a situation where fake news absolutely changed something. If you're talking about the German elections, that's a whole different
story.
Let's
talk about that later. John, why do you think did Donald Trump win? Do you think there was a big influence really from social media and the web? Is it like he said, you know, like Hillary wasn't just that popular?
I think that there are a lot of reasons. And in an election where it was basically decided with less than 100,000 votes spread across three states, almost any variable you can identify could theoretically have swung that many votes. But I do think the dislike of Hillary Clinton and what she represented was probably the single biggest variable. And she was a very unique candidate in that... Sorry about that. So she was a very unique candidate in that she, in a way that isn't generally the case for Democratic candidates, was almost certainly going to be the nominee, at least going in. There was a strong primary challenge from Bernie Sanders, but it looked like she was very powerful. She was going to be the candidate, but she was also uniquely despised in almost every way that a politician can be. Ideologically, in terms of what sort of Democratic politician she represented, people were growing to despise that. Personally, a lot of her characteristics, whether it's the way that she communicates or some of the double standards that people have in terms of how they view female politicians, her personal history, people love to pick that apart, both on the right and on the left. The way that she campaigned, her strategy was archaic, and it didn't respond to Donald Trump's clearly trying to make inroads into states like Wisconsin and Michigan and things like that. So basically, all of the different ways that she could mess up the election, the ways that her personal characteristics could influence the election, I feel like she was uniquely poorly positioned to deal with Donald Trump. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that Donald Trump didn't do anything right. I think that considering that the demographic roadmap for a Republican president to win now is getting smaller and smaller, I think that he did all that he could with that. And I think that he correctly realized that there were certain states where economically things have not been going well for several decades in the United States, and he desperately needed to get those people on his side, both by, I would say, sort of falsely communicating what his economic agenda is. I don't think that his policies will actually advantage these people in the future. And then also playing up in the same way that a lot of right-wing populists in Europe have, fears over Muslims and Sharia law and ISIS, but also the sort of general law and order, the Black Lives Matter is the problem in the inner cities. I mean, he spoke a lot about that. So I think that both candidates were influential, but I think that it was Hillary Clinton's election to lose, and I think that that's what she did.
You just mentioned you covered a lot of elections in the last years in your career. What do you think really changed in the communication of the politicians to the crowd?
Well, they have always attempted to go over the media if they can. Even going back 100 years, they were attempting to find different ways to communicate directly to people and not having to go through channels. But now they have Twitter, and now they have social media, and now they have lots of different types of news outlets that will pick up something that they've said and run with it and start to develop stories that become myths, actually, and become false and start to kind of snowball. And I think that that's something that's positively dangerous. But what we've learned from the last couple of years of seeing the rise of fake news, I think, has done nothing more for me than encourage me and the other people from serious news outlets that our job is valid and important. And we have to try and provide that counter, the freedom of speech and the freedom to report properly on what's really happening with the candidates. Because when you look at what Trump has to say, it's kind of crazy rantings. And of course, the Twitter format encourages that too. I mean, you have to be impactful. The way that headlines are written and the way that algorithms with search and things work mean that you tend to take out phrases and little words, things like the alternative facts thing, which just became such a massive buzz on Twitter when it happened. And it was kind of squeezed into little sentences, and it suddenly came up into search terms. And obviously, the politicians are very smart. They take advantage of that. Now, I think there's a huge responsibility on us, but we're aware of it, and we know it, that we need to make sure we tell the truth and really dig deep to find out the truth.
You just mentioned it. Social media is really emotion-driven, Trump really plays it very well to you know, get the emotions from everybody. But how can a news outlet or a news organizations like Euronews, survive in that and get the point and get read or get reached the audience when everything is just fact-driven, but quite boring in the end.
Yeah, I agree. There's a challenge for us. And one of the reasons that I think I was talking to one of our correspondents, Valerie Goria, who has traveled to war zones all around the world and covered lots of elections in Western Europe as well. And she was saying that she thinks that one of the reasons we've got to the point that we have actually is that the big media organizations have tended to accept pressure from outside sources because they need money, so they tend to take on sponsoring, not for news, I'm not saying news is sponsored, but for magazine content and things. They tend to have pressure from the media owners. They can, I mean, and that's something that's there across different types of media, but TV broadcasters are definitely amongst them. And they've had cuts in budget. And so it's really tricky to be able to go out there and to really do a good job of reporting when you haven't got the freedom of budget to go out there. How many reporters do I know who've got the money to go reporting with a TV crew? There are hardly any that I can think of. Valerie is actually one of them. She's free to choose her stories and free to go where she wants. That's one of the things that's eroded the credibility of the mainstream news organizations and let us get to this point. But I think now we feel like, okay, we caught it, we understood it, we realized there's a problem. Hopefully it will improve in the future.
John, you're not from a traditional news organization. You have a YouTube channel. How do you put the politics stuff in the YouTube channel, and how does the audience react to that?
So our network has dozens of channels. Only several of them are mainly focused on politics, but the one that I do most work on is politics focused. And I think the reason that early on, and the show has been going on for something like 15 years in different incarnations on satellite radio, on Facebook, on YouTube, and all that. I think one of the reasons it was able to take off in the first place is that stylistically it was immediately apparent to anyone watching. If they go to one of our random clips on YouTube, it's that there is a feeling that we were being more honest. Early on, so we talked about how social media, you kind of have to be impactful, you have to be emotional. And there's an authenticity that comes from what seems to be a genuine expression of emotion. And so in our videos early on, this is before that I was a part of the channel, our founder, Cenk Uygur, he's a guy who will get passionate, he'll get red in the face, he'll yell and he'll scream, but he grounds those emotional outbursts in what I think is a clear understanding of the actual facts of the political situations that he's breaking down. And I think when people contrast that with the mainstream media and they watch Wolf Blitzer or whoever, it's very straight-laced. It's clear that they're reading a script that's been given to them. And there's advantages to that. Presentation of information can be much more succinct and efficient. You can, with the resources that channels like that have, you can do more international coverage, you can bring on experts. And all of those are advantages that I think a lot of the newer forms of media have got to try to get some version of. But in terms of appearing to be authentic, appearing to be basically like a regular person, but a little bit more informed and more passionate, I think that people, there was a niche for that. And I think that people wanted that. And especially there are certain topic areas that I'm not too sure about in Europe, but in America, income inequality is talked about a little bit now, but generally has not been talked about in the mainstream media. Police brutality, it was online media that really started to make that the big story that it is now. It had always existed, but it was online sources that really started to cover it more. Recently,
why do you think
but
that is?
Why did that happen?
Yeah.
I think one of the reasons is, to some extent, it can be for some topics, not necessarily for police brutality, but that in the US, our cable news channels they require a lot of advertising. They have huge corporate, I mean, they're owned by GE and defense contractors and things like that. They have a message that they have to get across. Are you really going to give an accurate depiction of the state of climate change research if an oil company is your chief sponsor? If you see Wolf Blitzer say something about climate change and he brings on a guy who says, hey, it looks like all of our scientific research says that this is happening, and then he has a guy that says, we're not really sure, cut to break and it's BP and Shell that are advertising, who's gonna trust that? Now, we don't have sponsors like that. I'd love to have sponsors. We certainly don't have sponsors like that. And so people, I feel like they can trust us more on certain topics. Things like police brutality, it's a different topic. There aren't necessarily financial incentives for the media to not cover it, but it's outside of their bubble. The vast majority of those channels are headquartered in DC, New York, and perhaps a few in LA, maybe a bit in Miami. They're not in Ferguson, they're not in Flint, and so they're not necessarily gonna catch those stories.
What's your response to
that?
Yeah,
no, and I think actually the place where you get the truth and great reporting on that is local newspapers, local radio, yes. because those guys are really close to it, and that's where I started out. That is actually, as a journalist, the most fun, because you're really close to your audience, you're really in it, you really know what they care about. Something you were talking about there, about the fact that, you know, for example, talking about climate change, they feel the need to show the other side. There's a nice line in the that American TV series, Newsroom, where that one of the characters says that news organizations have a bias towards impartiality, and so they feel the need to show two sides to a story. Something like climate change doesn't have two sides to the story, but they feel the need to show it because they're supposed to do their job and show they're being journalists and there's two sides to this, but actually there aren't. And I certainly think that pressure from shareholders and sponsors is a worrying trend. It's something that lots of the news organizations do, and it isn't news, it isn't the news bits, it's the other parts when they'll suddenly, you'll find that they spend 15 minutes talking about an airport in Kazakhstan or the cuisine of the Philippines, and you go, wonder why they're talking about this. Well, maybe it's because they received $500,000 to do so, but they're not telling you about that. They're not being honest. I'm sure you guys would and say, hey, we've got 10,000. Look, well, we're going to talk about this wonderful stir-fry system. You know, maybe we could do open advertising like that and tell everybody how much money you got.
Well, and there was a personal version of that in the last election where very often MSNBC and CNN, they would have on campaign surrogates for candidates. And they wouldn't identify them as paid employees for these candidates. It would seem as if they were giving their honest opinion, but they're simply delivering a message they were paid to give. Mm.
Let's go back to the US election again. Which influence did fake news really have? What do you think?
I would say that I don't think that fake news had probably had a very impactful election. I think that people take their decisions on voting based on what their friends say, what their family say, what they've always done over the course of their voting career. I don't think that enough people would get swung by particular fake stories to really swing an election either way. I think that it certainly can influence the debate during the election campaign. I could say it definitely influences the election campaign. Does it influence the result? I'm not sure. In the American one, I'm not sure I was close enough to be able to tell you. I would say in Europe, no way that it would actually influence the result, but it certainly has a role to play in the way that the whole campaign runs out.
I don't know that necessarily inside of one election you can necessarily say how influential it was. One thing that I think that we should acknowledge, and so you mentioned this when you were talking about the propaganda campaign around Crimea, is that fake news and Twitter bot networks and things like that, they do target particular politicians and political parties, but they're not limited to that. They can attack social movements. They can attack nonprofits. Like we had Occupy Wall Street, a big protest movement in the U.S., and there was fake news concerning that, and there was also completely biased mainstream media coverage of it. There's a lot of fake news being spread around the Dakota Access Pipeline protests of the last year. Black Lives Matter is very often, there's huge viral stories about that they support violence, that they said a certain thing, and then you find out it's not true, but that can influence people's views, not just about a politician, but about the grievances of a community. Yeah. And so I think that the effect of fake news can be, even outside of an election context, can have a negative impact. In terms of elections, though, well, I don't know that fake news by itself is all that dissimilar from chain emails and things like that. It looks a little bit more official, and so some people who would not have been taken in by chain email might spread it. My fear with fake news, though, is that it seems like just another tool in the toolbox of those who want to destroy people's faith in objective reality. There's been a long time, the Republicans in America have told us not to trust teachers, they're all liberal propagandists. You can't trust scientists, it's all hoaxes, and they're paid to lie to you. You can't trust the mainstream news. And I think that a lot of the people that spread fake news aren't doing it because they think it's real, but because they like that it's not. Surveys have shown that like one out of three spread it knowing that it's fake because it's entertaining. It's about people's faith in institutions and in the search for knowledge, for objective truth, that being broken down. And I think fake news is just a very visible form of it.
I would say the other thing you have to think about is what's our definition of fake news? Because I think what John's talking about here is actually fake, made up, completely false.
And made to look like it's from MSNBC or CNN.
Yeah, yeah, and that stuff's awful. That is terrible. But I think we're onto it. I think we know it's there. And I think anybody who's paying attention will start to be thinking perhaps more critically. I would say longer term, quite a few people I've talked to about this while preparing this debate have said that they think there should be education, actually. That you know, the 20-year plan should be that you educate people to think better about it. I would say the more problematic type of fakeness is actually just poor journalism. It's people, that's not necessarily because the journalist themselves is doing a bad job, it's because they're under pressure, or they haven't got the money to go out and go and meet people, they haven't got the right contacts, people won't return their calls, they're not able to get the facts straight, then they don't know necessarily who the different people are that they should call. A lot of newsrooms these days are staffed by people who are young, who have under very, very tight deadlines, and they need to get a story done, and they can start to make mistakes. When I started out in journalism, we always said, you should be never wrong for long, basically admitting that you would be wrong. And certainly what the coverage of the London terrorist attacks this week was a perfect example of that, where during the first hour and a half, 2 hours afterwards, there was a lot of stuff that was fake, that wasn't true, that came out. And then you got the facts straight, and the mainstream media got the facts straight about it. But I think that's, you know, those beginner level fake news, which isn't fake, it's just slightly wrong, is much more problematic, and there's an awful lot more of that goes on. I know from being inside newsrooms around Europe that it definitely happens. You realize you get stuff wrong, and or you get steered in one direction because there's a particular bias towards going to one country because it's easier to go there, or to go to the press officer from that organization is much easier to deal with, so he's the one who gets the interview. That kind of thing happens all the time, and that's actually more problematic, and that's a real challenge to overcome that.
But you just said, you know, if we had more money, everything would be better.
Generally say that a lot.
He doesn't have that much money, and he's getting the audience.
He's getting a great audience online. I mean, although TV audiences are different to online audiences, and if you're looking at actual figures, numbers of people sitting down watching something, TV audiences are bigger, but people watch online news differently, don't they? They watch it in an active way. They're kind of part of it. I would say the great thing about your network is the fact that you provide an alternative, because here in Germany, in France, we've got political candidates from the hard left, from the pro-business liberals you've got in Germany, you've got the Greens, you've got proper Green Party, you know, not a Green Party that gets 0.5%. You've got a Green Party that gets serious percentage points. You've got a Left Party that gets serious percentage. You've got serious kind of Catholic Christian who get a lot of votes as well. You've got a lot of variety. The same thing in France, but in Germany, in the US, you've got two parties. You don't get much diversity. So it's great to be able to listen to your network and have some diversity. I think that's the great thing that you bring.
With especially Donald Trump, and you just mentioned it, there's a new discussion of journalism in the society. You know, he's always complaining about all the journalists, just as you said. When Angela Merkel was there last week, she praised the free press in front of him. What's the learning for you in this? Not the learning, but what can you do what do you do to be trusted?
To be trusted in this new environment. I mean, I think, especially after the inauguration, a lot of journalists have felt the need to sort of band together to defend not just each other when individual outlets or journalists are attacked, like Jim Acosta at CNN was lambasted by Sean Spicer, by Donald Trump, but also to defend the idea of journalism itself, which seems ridiculous, but also seems necessary at this point. So I think that supporting each other, dialing back a little bit of the infighting, which at least in America has always been a part of our media, mocking each other and saying, you know, that they're biased and all that. We still do that, but we need to dial it back a little bit. But I would go back to the education point. I think that one of the things that'll be necessary to reassure people that they can trust the things that they're hearing, whether it's from an online source or from the mainstream media, is to, one, limit the sort of journalistic mistakes and biases that you were talking about. And at least in America, there's a lot of that. A lot of it's financial, but it's also, it's tied in with the funding being taken from investigative journalism and international news and things like that. But I also think that we have to educate people about how to determine if a particular news story is likely to be true.
How can we do that?
Well, there are various tools on the internet, thankfully. So if you're watching our show, you're already generally on a computer or a smartphone, so it's easy to, if you see a picture and it purports to be from a particular protest, do a reverse image search and see if that image actually is from 10 years ago. You can go to something like Snopes or various other fact-checking sites, and thankfully, a little bit late in the game, Facebook is now doing some of that in an automated way. When people share stories that have been disproven on fact-checking sites, it'll sometimes automatically post it. But also, if there are stories that are extremely widespread and aren't true, aren't based in truth, then we need to cover that as well. We need to cover the real news, but we also need to strike down the news that distracts people or gives them a false impression of what's going on. And hopefully, in a combination of showing when people are being deceived, but also holding ourselves to a high standard, I hope that eventually we can win back some of the trust that to some extent legitimately has been lost, but to some extent has been taken away by people like Donald Trump, who have a personal motivation to destroy people's faith in journalists.
What does Euronews do?
What does Euronews do? Well, you know, we do our best every day, all the time, 24 hours a day to try and tell you the truth, to try and check it, to try and make sure. One of the great things is it's a very international newsroom. Okay, we've got 13 languages at Euronews. I sit in an office, I mean, I cover science and technology. Scientists do tend to tell you the truth. It's one of the reasons I do that. My colleague to my right is Spanish. Over there is my Russian colleague. In front of me, I've got a French colleague. I'm behind a Brazilian colleague. I've got colleagues from Germany all around me. If you go to the newsroom, you've got I've got colleagues from Iran, from lots of the Arab-speaking countries, from Russia, from Ukraine. It's great to see at Euronews the Russians and Ukrainians go out and have a cigarette and go drinking together and have a lovely time. That, I suppose, is the great value from what happens at our building, is the fact that I can say to a Spanish colleague, well, what is actually happening in your political process at the moment? When the Portuguese elections was looking a little bit shaky, we didn't know who was going to win, you could go to a Portuguese person and try and get an answer. And that is a wonderful resource. I suppose that's the richness of our news organization. Not everybody knows that because they don't work in our wonderful green cube in Lyon in France, where we're based. But that, I suppose, is the first step. The other thing is making sure you use reliable sources. I mean, we don't just pick out stuff from the internet. We don't just kind of grab stuff off Twitter. You just don't do that. You spend your time waiting to see if Reuters has reported it. What's AFP saying? Again, we're not just following the English-speaking agencies either. We're following what ANSA has to say, what EFE has to say, what the Russian agencies say, what the news agencies in Cairo are saying about something. If you pull all those sources together, you might start to see the truth. But it's tricky. It's a tricky job. But, you know, that's the fun of it, too.
it's widely discussed that social media really locks you up in some kind of filter bubble. Do you agree with that?
That social media provides, yeah, I mean, I think the internet generally does. It's been great that thanks to the rise of the first, like, blogs and podcasting, but also YouTube channels and Facebook and things like that, has allowed, the cost to get involved in the game is much lower than it's ever been, which has its negatives, but it also has its positives. But if you can easily create like the Young Turks, or if Alex Jones can easily make a channel, that's good because it provides diversity, but it also allows people to self-select their news and to not often necessarily have their preconceived notions about politics of the world challenged. And that can definitely be a negative. Social media, I think, is just another level of that. And I think we haven't talked too much about the fake accounts on Twitter, but I think that this is one of the areas where it can be really negative, that if you have a particularly niche, perhaps uninformed view about a particular topic, we know psychologically that if it's reinforced by a lot of people seeming to agree with you, you're not just more likely to express that belief, but the strength of your belief will be strengthened as well. And so when we see the rise of fake, like, bot accounts on Twitter, especially in the US election of last year, that can be negative because it tells people that they're right, that there is a lot of other people who are saying what they're saying, they're liking and retweeting it. I saw a stat. At one point, two of the most popular hashtags that Trump was spreading was MAGA, Make America Great Again, and Crooked Hillary. And during one multi-month period, 80% of the references to those two hashtags came from fake accounts. And so I saw that so much. It made me believe that there were more Americans that were enthusiastic about that message than there actually were. And I like to think that I'm a little bit more critical than a regular person who's got a busy life and spends a little bit of time on Twitter. But when you take that and you spread it across multiple elections, and you have websites that have supporters that are fake bot networks, and the rise of the alt-right, who are not actually a large group, but have a lot of fake Twitter accounts that seem to increase their reach and their influence, I think that can give people a false impression of what the world's actually like. And that's not just a bubble. That's a corrosive influence on society and on our elections.
But what's the solution for that?
I mean, one of the solutions is that thankfully groups like Twitter, they're getting better. It's a constant war where their ability to weed out these fake bot Twitter accounts is always improving, but the ability of the Twitter accounts to be better at seeming human is also increasing. It's an arms race on social media. I think that they need to do a good job there. In terms of the ability of media outlets, I'm not necessarily sure how we can fight that. We can try to identify if it's a particularly influential account. And there are some bot accounts that have 30, 40, 50,000 followers, which seems crazy. We can try to point those out. But to some extent, I think the answer is less from the media and more from technology.
What's your opinion?
Yeah, I think I've got a couple of points on that. First one would be, yes, I think that Twitter, trending topics on Twitter is a problem. I love Twitter, it's great, but one of the things to bear in mind is that journalists follow journalists on Twitter, and so when they want to check information, they'll go and have a look and see what the other journalists are doing, and they will have a look to see what's trending, and that can actually end up influencing what they think might be the news agenda that day. So I think that's kind of a poisonous thing that you're talking about. But I hope that journalists will also do their job and go and check other sources and check with their colleagues. But I know we've got an audience here which is probably very plugged in, but if we're talking about influencing elections, an awful lot of people don't go on Twitter, an awful lot of people don't go on Facebook, don't care about that. They watch the news at 8 o'clock in the evening on the TV, and they don't spend their time wandering around on social media. They don't really get influenced by it. So I don't think that, you know, at the end of the day, an election can be swung by that. But certainly a day's news can be swung by it. And we just have to be more careful. As I said, we're aware of it. We've had our orange warning light, perhaps the red warning light in some cases, and we know that we need to jump to it quickly and be sure that you don't just say, oh good, that hashtag is trending, it must be a big story. It might be it's just powered by bots, as you say.
When we spoke yesterday, you mentioned a really interesting thought about alternative facts.
Yes.
What's your opinion on alternative facts?
Well, alternative facts, it's interesting if you watch the whole interview, actually, on Meet the Press, where alternative facts came up.
And it's Kelly Conway who
she came up with that phrase when she was talking on Meet the Press about the inauguration and the number of people that were there. The interview itself is 13 minutes long. It's worth a watch. I think that actually, what she was making reference to is something that politicians and journalists do all of the time, which is selecting facts that meet the argument that they want to make. And so if you're a journalist and you're writing a story about obesity or you're writing a story about climate change or something, you'll try and find a fact. And so you'll go around and search and you'll go, okay, over the last 5 years, we've had the X number of temperature or we've got X number of obese people. That's not enough. It's not shocking enough. Let's look at 10 years. Oh, good. I've got a good number there. So I chose an alternative fact. Look, it's 10 billion on this one, but if I look at that one, it's 0.5 billion. It's not enough. It's not a good story. I can sell it to my editor if it's 10 billion. So I've got a number here, and I'm going to go with it, and it makes a great top line or a great second line. It boosts it up. I can put it on Twitter. I've got a nice lead. So I think that the alternative facts concept that she was making crude reference to is actually much more subtle and much more problematic. It's actually, you know, you're a journalist. It's part of the job of journalism is that we end up doing this kind of thing. You go, actually, that doesn't support my argument. I need to find another fact that supports the argument of this story that I'm going through because my interviewee just said that, you know, this is what I've got to get this finished by 5 o'clock, so I need some facts. That's the kind of thing that happens. Unfortunately, and I'm sure you can say that exactly the same thing in news from your news experience as well. That puts us under an awful lot of pressure. But we haven't got time. We've got, you know, I've got 2 minutes to cover something, or 1 minute, or, you know, if I'm lucky, I've got 5 or 6 minutes to cover something. You guys are, I guess, a bit more lucky because you've got quite a lot of time, haven't you? Maybe not the same pressures.
The show's about 2 hours, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we don't do 24 hours a day. So certainly that allows us to pace ourselves a little bit. But we do still have to respond to breaking news, sometimes even in the middle of the show.
Yeah.
So there's a version of that pressure.
Yeah, but do you agree what I'm saying about looking for facts that kind of back up arguments, just like politicians do, that kind of happens?
Well, I mean, I think that's a very human thing. I think the journalists are humans, and we have various like tools for simplifying a complex world. So I do think that we have to be careful of that. I think Kellyanne Conway, I mean, when I think of alternative facts so far coming out of this administration, I think of their assertions that his inauguration crowd was larger than Obama's. That's
madness.
Sort of,
yeah.
When he says alternative facts, he means a convenient lie. And
yeah.
they don't
yeah.
fundamentally care at the end of the day.
Seemingly not.
The weird thing is that if you have political goals, if you have political policies, and you believe that they're right, not just because you like the outcome, but because you believe the data that you're feeding into that equation is true, you can be misled into believing that all the other parties are doing the same thing, but it's not necessarily the case. Sometimes they just like the outcome. And alternative facts are a great way to muddy the waters, confuse the issue until you get that outcome.
Actually, also, it's deeply confusing if you're a journalist and you're on the receiving end of this stuff. And certainly the correspondents from Euronews I've been talking to about this, they said that that's a big problem. You'll get something quoted at you by a politician or a spokesman. More often than not, it's not actually the politician. It's one of their lackeys who's kind of gives you some facts and says it's like this. And you're like, is it? I don't know. I need to go and check. And you've
because they don't have the live fact-checking necessarily to disprove it, and they don't necessarily feel comfortable, although I think in the U.S. media they're starting to get comfortable, in just saying, no, you're lying to me.
Yeah.
It seems impolite, basically.
It does.
But it might be more and more necessary.
I see a wonderful awakening on the part of the American media when it comes to that. They're kind of going, rising to the challenge and saying, come on then, okay, we're up for a fight.
Yeah, about a year and a half too late, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Let's just move... A quick look to Europe again. We talked a lot of the US elections, and we had a big election in the Netherlands last week. We will have France, and we will have Germany too. What do you expect in the influence of social media and the web from these elections?
You haven't mentioned the B word yet, Brexit.
Sorry.
No, that's a big one. That's
a that was
one.
Last year.
That's a massive one where I think a lot of fakeness over decades. Fakeness generally, not deliberately fake all the time, but quite often deliberately fake, actually swung the election. I don't think the Dutch one was about that. Geert Wilders was a bit of a fake story in a lot of the English-speaking media because they were like, oh, great, this fits our narrative of these crazy blonde fascist nationalist people who are going to take over Europe and America. Actually, he's been a member of parliament for an extremely long time. He's part of the narrative over there. He's got fewer seats than he had in 2010. I don't think there was much influence there from talking to my colleague who was there influencing it. In France, you've got seven very serious candidates for the presidency. Nobody knows who's going to win. I'm there and I'm reading news shared by people on Facebook and from the mainstream news media. I don't think there's a big fake news problem there in France, and I get the impression in Germany it's the same thing. On Brexit, however, I would say that I think that basically the whole, most of the media, probably most of the newspapers you can buy in the shops were biased against the European Union and have been so throughout my life. And they never properly explained the benefits of the European Union, the way it allowed us to move around and to travel and to work in different countries, to have peace and to come up with really, really good laws that protected people's rights. And that was never properly explained. I mean, the only people were The Guardian who did that, but they were always considered to be, oh, that's The Guardian. Well, no. It was so deeply annoying. And an awful lot of people who I know voted for Brexit, and they did so on false grounds that came from fake reporting, wrong reporting for decades. So that was a terrible, terrible, terrible result, personally, I felt, and one that exactly came from lies.
John?
I mean, I would definitely say I followed it to the extent that many American journalists did, which is obviously to a much lesser extent. But I believe that going up to it, one of the concerns was that the way the media frames how likely a political event is to happen can also make a big difference. I mean, people are concerned about how turnout affected Brexit in particular areas. And I think with Brexit, with Donald Trump, I think that we have to be careful in how in the media we express certainty about what's going to happen, because that can affect the result. You can have self-fulfilling prophecies or, I guess, self-failing prophecies. If you tell people, don't worry about this, polls show it's not going to happen, and then that swings the result, that's definitely concerning. And I mean, people are looking for ways to tell what's going to happen. So with the Dutch, they're saying, well, look, the worst outcome didn't occur. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you can then say France is going to go a particular way, especially when there's as much uncertainty as there is. And so I think that the media has to be very careful how they cover the particular issues like Brexit, how they cover some of the issues that are being exploited by these populists in multiple countries, like the immigration crisis, refugees and all that. I think that to some extent that's what they can do. In terms of the social media side, I'm not as sure.
Thank you very much. The time is up. We just got the bomb blinking. Thank you very much. And I think we all have to do our jobs better than before. And good luck with that. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.